I'm Augie Sallas, I'm president of the community council.
I'm Senator Hernandez, I work for Viva Entertainment. We put shows at La Sagrada Halloween and all these other venues.
In Bartos Enriquez, vice president of the community council.
I'm Rosendo Carrasco, I own a real estate company called The Creeper in Wicker Park, and I do different, I'm an entrepreneur actually.
Victor Guerrero, good morning, just a volunteer.
I'm Manny Martinez, and I own Martinez Funeral Home here in Little Village.
Jose Caez, SEIU 73/private consultant.
Refugio Gonzalez, but my friends and enemies call me Reggie. Yeah. Volunteer for Little Village Community Council, and editor and publisher of El Latino Voice.
Gay Wheel, also known as Cuz, a member of Community Council.
Thank you so much. We have an agenda which I'd like to follow so we know where we're at. And I passed out news article that was in this week's Longdale News for everybody to read. So that's the introduction. So now we have the guests. Go ahead, everyone, introduce yourself and Fernando.
Great. Good morning, everyone. Again, my name is Evelyn Rodriguez. I'm actually from the neighborhood. I grew up right off of 26 Sawyer. So it's a pleasure to be here this morning. Thanks for coordinating the meeting. I joined the office of the mayor about 2 months ago now as an advisor in the Office of Public Engagement. And so while my focus is engagement citywide, I do have a particular focus in our predominantly Latino neighborhoods, serving as a liaison to Latino community-based organizations, it's all institutions. So you can see me as a liaison. Like I said, I've been on the job for about 2 months. I used to work for an alderman in the first ward, Alderman Moreno, which covers the areas of Wicker Park. As well, and I was there for about 3 years. Prior to that, I worked for Erie Neighborhood House, where I worked with Bella Fessa. That was a while ago. The Erie House, they have a location here in Little Village, and I organized their housing program. And then prior to that, I worked in Congressman McGinnis's Washington, D.C. office, and worked on immigration reform and other policies around there. The policies relating to the 4th Congressional District, which is here in Chicago. So I was there for about 4 years, and born and raised here in the neighborhood. And
prior to retired?
I was in college, yes. I'm dating myself. But long time resident, so.
Go ahead, and Fernanda, how about you?
Good morning. Well, I don't have that connection. Bernita Johnson Gabriel. I am not a native Chicagoan. I grew up in North Carolina, and I relocated here from Boston, Massachusetts, back some 25 years ago, I guess. I've been with the mayor's office since August of last year. I am the senior advisor of neighborhood development and housing. So my role is to make sure that we are coordinating and sort of bringing all of our resources, both city departments and private, together to make the most impact in community development. I think those of you who have been doing this work for a while, you'll notice that things are very siloed in the city. And so what we're doing is trying to break down those silos and start talking to each other across departments so that we can do more holistic planning for community development and not just have so many one-off projects here and there. So bringing connectivity to the work. Prior to my role at the city, I was the executive director for a not-for-profit organization called Quad Communities Development Corporation, or QCDC. They are a LISP lead organization. Many of you may remember the LISP, Local Initiative Support Communities program, which sponsored the new communities program. So there were about 16 agencies throughout the city, a part of that program, and my organization was one. It was created exactly for that program. And those communities include North Kenwood, Oakland, Douglas, and Graham Boulevard. So just a little bit east of here and a little bit south. So I'm very excited to be here this morning, particularly on 26th Street, which is one of the busiest, obviously, corridors in the city. So I hope that after this, I'll get to walk around a little bit and shop. Just one of my favorite pastimes. And very interested in hearing what your issues and concerns are and how you feel that we can work better with you.
Renita, do you like Mexican food?
I love Mexican food. Absolutely.
That was a test.
Absolutely. And I, believe it or not, I did attempt to make some dishes.
It was a test.
Myself.
Yes.
Well, the best Mexican food is in
one of
them. The
best
Mexican food is in
Lagos.
Yes.
Well, we have a lot of nice restaurants.
Yes.
You can find all the things. Well, I wanted to start off by giving you a little background information. We have been interested in economic development for some time. We've had 5 community meetings that we hosted, and we invited the alderman, Ricardo Munoz, to those 5 meetings, and he refused to come. So we're in the dark, actually, as to what's going to be developed on 26th and Kostner, that property on the northwest corner there. We used to have more property that was vacant there on the southwest corner, but that's gone now. We'd like to hear from you if you know of any economic development being done in the 22nd Ward or Little Village. We'd like to know about it. We'd like to know if there's anything planned for 26th and Kostner. We'd like to know everything. If you could share with us information you have regarding economic development in Little Village, because we don't see that. If there is some, we don't know about it. I don't know. Nobody. We don't know. If Augie Sallas doesn't know, like they said, it's pretty awesome. If Augie Sallas doesn't know, nobody knows.
Okay, you said that's the northwest corner?
It's the northwest corner of 26th and Kostner. And that's getting down to the, that's 6 and 7, that's the two of you. And then we can have more discussion about what we think ought to be there. We don't know if there's any plan there, if there's any development going to go on there. We know the building was burnt down 6 months ago. How long ago?
Not sure. Just 2-3 months ago.
Yeah. 2-3 months, the building was burnt down. There was talk about affordable housing there at one point. I don't know if it's still open or what. We did not support the open affordable housing. We think it should be something for the residents to benefit by that property, but it's something for the benefit of the community.
What was the building and do you know the owner of the
property? Mercy Housing?
No, it was Little Village LLC that owned it, but they kept saying that Mercy bought it.
Who owns it now?
Little Village LLC.
Little Village LLC owns it.
And I don't think you can get any info because I think they're registered in New York, the LLC.
And prior to the fire, it was what?
It was a furniture store.
It was a what?
An abandoned factory.
Oh, it's abandoned.
Yeah, it used to be a store client, children or nursery furniture. And they went out of business and then it was abandoned for years, 30, 40 years.
Oh.
And one time the alderman at that time was Chuy Garcia. And they talked about he was going to do something to build that property up. And then he was alderman of the state center, and then he became an executive director of the Little Village Economic Development Corporation. And they were going to build something on both sides, the north side and the south side. And nothing. They developed nothing. So we, I guess, Bill and Maine's company bought the south west corner, and they're going to build a factory there now. North west corner, that's that empty lot. So we want to know if you can tell us what's going to go on with that property. Can we have something like an Odeum type of a concept in Villa Park? A lot of Mexican people go there to for entertainment, for all kinds of different events, and that's something that we're interested in seeing here. All the things that we have on the bottom there, arts and crafts, sports, rodeo exhibitions, soccer, boxing, weddings, cultural center, senior center, youth center, Mexican museum, stadium, entertainment.
So lots of ideas and recommendations. What we'll do when we go back is, there'll be a couple of things that I'll do. One is I'll check with the Department of Planning.
Okay.
To see if they are aware of any activity taking place here.
Okay.
I think one of the very first things that we are going to have to do is figure out who the owner is.
Right.
Because that tells the story. Yeah, that's going to tell the story. It's not city-owned property, so it's nothing that the city can dictate. And so just finding out who the owner is and perhaps then checking with the Alderman's office to see if there have been conversations with the owner. Unfortunately, in many of our neighborhoods in Chicago, we have absentee owners. And they're not really forced to do anything with the properties that are abandoned as long as they continue to pay their taxes, their property taxes. One of the things that we are trying to do is work with the Department of Buildings on situations like that where you have abandoned buildings that are a drag on commercial revitalization to try to, you know, take action on those buildings. In this case, however, you're telling me the building's gone and it's just vacant land.
The big one is
missed. Well, they're just gone. Because it was in a landmark. And the Alderman had a meeting like a couple of months ago. And on their display, they had new buildings already built. And the building was not burned yet. And they had like, they had a design.
So someone came to the community with a proposal.
Yeah, and they had.
That was the affordable housing that you're talking about.
Yes, they had five buildings built, but that building was still there. Mm-hmm. So then weeks later, the building burned down because the city had required them to treat the asbestos.
Was this last year?
Yeah, they had a court order that they actually had asbestos and it was terribly burned. And they blamed the homeless who had extended in that building.
Okay. So
that's just to show that there's a lot of funny stuff going on with our Alderman. So he might give you the runarounds. But everyone, you should have some, you could let us know what you know when you are with Erie House, if there's to continue with it.
Right, so, and I shared a little bit, I don't know the status of the building now. Like you said, it sounds like there's a new owner of it, but when
there's no building there.
Right. So they owned the plot of land south on the southwest corner and the Storkline building. Okay. The Storkline building was landmark status because it used to be a furniture store for baby furniture.
Mm-hmm.
They developed. Plan proposals, and typically when you develop plan proposals for a property, you work through the alderman. It's really the alderman. It's their decision ultimately in terms of the zoning of the property, what gets to go there. And so these meetings happened where Mercy was proposing their plan development was mixed finance housing on the Storkline.
Okay.
So it was a combination of, I don't know if they were using TIF, I can't remember, but it was like CHA, it was a mixed finance.
And everybody was going to put money up there.
So the idea was to have the building with the community center, and they were going to develop the southwest corners with like townhomes, right? It was like a five-phase plan, something along those lines. But it stalled, and then I left Erie House. I don't think anything happened of it, right? Clearly,
well,
we
were going to challenge the zoning because they had done the zoning wrong. They didn't post the posters in the right place. They posted it in the bus stop. So those were not visible. People didn't know that they were changing the zone. So we're going to challenge them on the zone. And the community got up and organized, and there was a lot of people in our hearing because they were opposed to the housing because the alderman never told anybody in the neighborhood. We have schools that are already overcrowded. This would have overcrowded our schools. This would have brought more residents to the community that we're not ready for that. So what we then had meetings and talked to the community and said, what is it that you want? They said, we need jobs. That's all we need jobs. So this expo, Augie brought it to our attention, an expo will bring in jobs, will bring in money, will bring in tourists to shop and eat at the restaurants here in Little Village, so all of us could get a piece of the pie, not just some of us. So that was our idea, but the Aldermen will never sit down with us and even listen to our idea. There's a rodeo here in Little Village, but that might be extinct pretty soon, and Viva runs it, the rodeo.
No, we have a 7-year contract.
Oh, you still 7 years?
Really?
Yeah. So we still have 7 years. What happens?
So, yeah, so, and then my understanding now is that the StorePoint building, you said it burned, but Unilever purchased the southwest corner, is that correct? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so.
Excuse myself, I have the service to prepare for.
Thank you for stopping by, Jenny. Thank you. Okay. See you again.
Now, I have a quick question, and this pertains to your comment. Your name? It's got like a Spanish my question is this, and I'm addressing your comment that you said the city, in relation to private ownership of land, you said that the city's hands are, you didn't say tied, but kind of led to that, you led to that that comment, and I thought that there was a, in terms of where the city saw that there was a piece of land that maybe was not being developed, that maybe the city thought that it could be used to serve the community and to, you know, to promote the city's tax base. The teachers, you know, there's no money for their pensions and all this stuff, so the city needs money. Now, isn't there a law, and maybe perhaps you can check with the Department of Law and find out if there is such a law that I've heard about, you know, in the news and such, mm-hmm. of the eminent domain, where the, you know, is there such a thing? Can you check with legal on those? Is that something that, are we getting ahead of ourselves, or is this something that can be checked out?
You're probably, for this particular situation, probably a little bit ahead of yourself. There is eminent domain. The city rarely uses it because it's very costly and it takes forever. So the city most likely would prefer to try to work with the owner to get them to develop it, is the most likely path that they would choose, and which is probably what the alderman was doing. So that I'm pretty sure that him working with Mercy on this development was part of that. It's very challenging and difficult for the city to do an eminent domain.
So the property no longer has a physical building on it. Prior to that, I guess there were some taxes that the city was collecting on it?
Well, the county collects taxes. And so as long as the property owner is paying their tax,
even there's no building on it, they still have to pay?
So really, basically, you guys are a bunch of sponges, so you're absorbing what we have to say, so we could probably have a follow-up, because like you said earlier to us, you got to start off from the beginning, the embryo stages, meaning you got to find out what's what on the building, because we could be talking all day here,
right.
and somebody already's got some plans or some ideas, or some, so we better just start, and then we could do whatever we have to do, but right now, we need to find out, you know, who owns it, and they're still paying taxes. We got buildings throughout the city like that. Everybody's always paying for it, and these folks are nowhere to be found.
But no, it's a vacant lot, so they're still paying taxes.
Oh, no, see, they pay for it, because if not, then the city would move on it,
okay.
You know, and then it wouldn't be an issue. But we have to find out first, and getting back to what you're saying, right, the post office was the same scenario. The city gave it to a guy or sold it to somebody. They did not do what they were supposed to do in a period of time, and then there was controversy over that, but somebody else came in there and stepped in and is going to do something about it. So the same thing you're talking about. So, but I think right now we could give Bernita so much information, and I guess if we're going to spend the next half hour, give as much information or whatever they're thinking, but we have to probably schedule another meeting down the road when she gets all this information, because we could go in circles back and forth out there.
So one of the things we'd like to know is there any economic development being done in Little Village right now? Is there anything being developed here in Little Village right now?
In terms of buildings?
Anything.
Like hotels, movie theaters, something that draws people to the area. You know, even Cicero is like, you know, sister, like a city or whatever, mm-hmm. or brother, whatever you want to call it. They got their movie theater. I don't see one in here. People
people here walk, people don't drive.
Yeah, because there's been talks, right, for years about what's going to happen. We can drive by the Kostner corridor. But it's finding out, like, what exactly is going on there now, right? I believe Unilever is it that a trucking company or something?
It's a mayo company.
Or mayo company on one corner, but they're talking specifically on the northwest corner, putting something like this. So we should just drive down there. So we can drive by,
and then what I can do when I get back to the office, as I said, my best point of contact is going to be the Department of Planning.
Yeah.
Because they know, if anyone has come in for city assistance, they have to go through the Department of Planning. So what I can do is just, you know, look at the area, have them look at the area and give us an idea of all development that's happening, and then we can email it to you so that you'll have a good idea of what's on the docket, what's being planned.
And in terms of development, there is along the parks area, there's a paseo that was announced a year ago. And so it's in terms of having moving forward with it, it's going to start off in Pilsen. So that area the building will begin on that area because there's still some cleanup and purchasing the rail tracks in Little Village because it's going to cost you Little Village. So those conversations will start happening during the year, and we'll have community meetings around that. So we'll be informing you of those community meetings in terms of that park.
And it goes to where
the rail track.
This come like, out, right? The back of this come out?
Yes.
The jail.
It's a rail track.
It's the wall by the jail.
Yeah.
2062nd.
Right. And then I believe it goes through the park, right? Because the tracks are like behind this Kamala, right? Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be a bicycle trail?
Yeah.
Is it like, is it 707? Is it 707?
Like the 606?
607.
Yes. The 606 is elevated because the tracks are elevated, but the paseo will be along the tracks that are unused. And I believe there is already some cleanup of some of the tracks. I know the crossing on 26, like by 31st, right by like by the used to be a Bank of America, right? Like they already paid
over
that.
Yeah, crime metal.
Yeah, exactly. So that's where you can like sort of follow those tracks. But there is some cleanup that needs to get done and some finalizing and purchasing. But again, a lot of that is through the Department of Planning, and that's why Bernie is here as our economic development advisor to sort of have keep you informed of those conversations.
I think if anything, you could feel the vibe here in regards to what the community wants versus, you know, and I guess there's where it starts because what Augie indicated earlier, trying to talk to the alderman and inviting him 5 times, not showing up.
Yeah.
But there's a group of folks out here in the community that are saying, look at this place.
Yeah.
It's completely jam-packed, no parking, and they want to experience like other folks, you know, a complex where they could go there and do some stuff and have events. I think we have a young lady over here that books a lot of events elsewhere, if I'm not mistaken, correct?
And we have the rights only through the summer, and we're only there in Saturday, Sunday. Sometimes, maybe once or twice during the week, but because there's no parking, and it's an open venue, we can't host events around here. Who's our target? Because we are in need. And we do host events at Allstate Arena. We host events all over the city and the suburbs because of the venue. And this place is great. I mean, we love it. You know, like I said, we have a 7-year contract. We want to extend it if possible. And we work there and we want to enhance it. But there's only so much we can do.
Right, because of
that. So if, you know, if there's another venue around here, we're willing to work. Right. And we bring artists from international artists. These are artists, you know, local and international. Chiquita, I mean, you're familiar with Chiquita.
It brings a lot of money.
No, but the Roga has been there for almost 30 years. I was a little kid when I was going there.
Yeah,
it's been there for years.
And it's a family. It's a family.
Yeah,
bit to some of the things that community wants. And let me just be very frank with you, because I live in a community where we have a wish list as well. Mm-hmm. The challenge, and I've done this work, I did this work at QCDC, of trying to bring venues, trying to bring business, trying to bring... It is very difficult because you are convincing someone to come to your community, to be a part of your community. It's so much easier said than it is done, especially in communities of color. So I'm just being very clear with you that this is not only a challenge that you see here, it is a challenge in lots of communities of color who spend daily trying to convince businesses, venues, to come to their communities. So I just want you to know that these, you know, because you're not seeing it happen, doesn't mean there aren't conversations going on and on and on and on, trying to bring these types of venues to communities of color.
Let me say this. You have to come and see 26th Street mm-hmm. in the summertime or any weekend, mm-hmm. bumper to bumper.
Right.
Mexicans are entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. They like to make money, they like to open up a business, and they take care of their business. Mm-hmm. You go down the street here, and you'll see how congested it is for parking.
Absolutely. Well,
and there's no parking. And the alderman knows it. He's been the alderman for 23 years. 23 years. Mm-hmm. I want to know what economic development has been done. He keeps saying, I build schools. He doesn't build schools. CPS builds schools. I mean, he's not even a tradesman. I mean, he's just a career politician. Never had a job.
In his defense, if CPS brought you a school, it was because of him and the mayor.
I was fighting
for schools before he was even the alderman.
Right. No, I'm just saying that CPS doesn't, typically, they don't open up a map and go, somebody has to push through.
I had two CPS presidents from mm-hmm. CPS to come here, and I took them around and told them, mm-hmm. we need a high school and we need grammar schools.
Right. But it has to come from somewhere. I know that.
And even Gary Chico was involved. But I had Raul Villalobos, who was the first Mexican-American who was president of the CPS. I had him come here. George Munoz, who was the second Mexican-American. You probably never heard of these people. Mm-hmm. But if you check the history, their pictures are on the wall there at the CPS. Raul Villalobos was the first Mexican-American to be president of the Chicago Board of Education. And George Munoz was the second. Mm-hmm. Both of them were lawyers. Mm-hmm. And both of them, I had them here and I took them around. And I told them, we need elementary schools. All of our elementary schools were overcrowded. Mm-hmm. And we could get rid of these boxcars they had in the parking yard, mobile classrooms. They got to get rid of them.
Oh, yes.
You know, mm-hmm. and we need a high school on the west side. We need a high school.
And I do remember
and this. Moms. And this was before Ricardo Munoz and Chuy were even involved mm-hmm. in any way. Mm-hmm. I was involved.
Right. I just wanted to, the challenge with this is also dealing with property owners. When private people own property, you know, you're at the will of that property owner. So even coming to them with a proposal or with a tenant, it is really, really challenging work. But so I don't want you to think that, you know, you haven't seen it. It's not coming. It doesn't mean that folks aren't really working hard trying to bring.
We want to know who those folks are. We want to know, you know, what they're doing. Mm-hmm. The alderman here does not come to public meetings. We've had five community meetings.
We even did a protest.
Yeah, we had a meeting at the Epiphany Church. We had 110 people there. It's a community meeting that we hosted, the Little Village Green Council. We had a meeting at Good Shepherd. Mm-hmm. We had 65 people there. Mm-hmm. And we had a meeting at Patriotic Park. We had somewhere around 60, 70 people there. We invited I personally hand delivered a letter to his office inviting him. I told him, Rick, I want you to come. He just took the letter, never showed up, never gave an answer, never sent anything. Then we had two meetings here, community meetings, we hosted. Give us information. Tell us what's going on 26th and Boston. Nothing. We had a protest because he's not listening to the community. He's got a core group of his political, I don't know what you want to call them, lackeys, or just tease us off because he disrespects the community. He does not engage with the community. He's got a core group of people that are working for him, and he has meetings that he gets 10 people, and 5 of them are staff people. I think the last meeting, Reggie went to, I think it was maybe a little more, maybe 12 people. And most of them, I think 10 of them were staff people. And he doesn't want to listen to the community. He doesn't account of what he does. I mean, he's been in there, I repeat, 23 years. He's to the point that he could care less what the community said. And we had an issue years ago, 2-3 years ago, about pawn shops. We had one pawn shop, then we had two. And then the community opposed any more pawn shops, and he favored it. He supported it. We got 5 pawn shops now.
One, two, about 4.
About 4 pawn shops now. We don't need pawn shops.
Let me ask you this. You all have talked about the parking situation. Is there some optimal location?
Yes.
That you have in mind for parking?
Yes, there's a location on Trumbull and 26, in Las Victorias, and it's big. You can build a 3-floor parking lot, entrance to Trumbull, exit to the LA.
And who owns it?
It looks like the Little Village Environmental Project has a garden there. So I think I don't know.
It's already a building?
No, it's empty.
It's a big empty lot.
La Victoria got burned down, or they just knocked it down?
I think they just knocked it down. That's where we fall. Everything comes back to ownership.
Exactly.
So
we understand that.
Yeah, so I'm going to see if we can find out who owns it.
Who owns that lot, right?
Right.
And parking could be...
Also, the Concordia, I mean, that's up for sale for the last couple of years, 2-3 years. That's right here on 26 in Hamlet. You could buy that thing and put a...
Is it still for sale?
You know, I can mention traffic. As far as driving traffic to the venue, if we have the right event, it's like I just work for iHeart Media. We have events all over the city and the country. These events, you have urban events that you take to all state arena. People will drive to go see the artists.
Right.
So here, Chicago is very segregated by choice. So this is great. I mean, we are in the community already. Mm-hmm. So now it's just getting the friends and the, you know, through company to come to the event,
right,
to come to the play. So as far as that, I mean, it's doable.
Oh, absolutely. You know, and most people would rather come to Chicago neighborhoods for something rather than go all the way out to all. I know I would much rather come here for an event, have dinner, walk around, and enjoy. That's much more enjoyable to me than going out to something like that.
Driving and being.
Right. Again, though, you know, the balance, someone mentioned balance. Mm-hmm. There is a balance. We are an urban city. That's just part of being an urban city. So, but there is a balance of where we can find ways to accommodate what we should.
So, one thing I wanted to say, you guys forgot to put the Lucha Libre on the bottom.
Lucha Libre.
You know Lucha Libre?
It's big
money in Mexico.
Right, so that 25 feet is up to their lot, and then that way, and that's it. And then there's this other big chunk.
I thought Mercy owned the entire thing, right?
No,
they were building the whole thing. So
it's not everything.
But now it's not Mercy, it's someone else. So we should just do like drive by it.
Yeah, I find out we're going all the way to the railroad tracks.
Yeah.
Because that's what we're aiming for.
Yeah.
The whole piece there.
For something like this.
Yes, we were thinking of also adding a hotel in there. Because of the distance of that we are from Midway, and it'll be great to say I'm staying in a little village in a hotel, so it will bring more money, more jobs. And somebody told us if I'm having like a convention here at Church Place, where are we going to stay?
Yeah. Well, it's going to be important to play that role, yeah, and that's going to dictate sort of the next steps, the next conversation.
transportation.
Yes, that will really put us on the map though as a community. That, you know, people say, I have my event in Little Village, I have my convention in Little Village. And that's something, instead of the negative media that we get all the time of murders, and that's not what we want. We want them to see the community for what it is.
It attracts, I think, 100,000 people.
More than that.
It's 15 feet deep on both sides of the street from Sacramento to Boston. And I see it every year. We put our chairs out in front here and we look at the parade from by. A lot of people, how they, where do they park? Who knows? But they do come to Little Village. You know what I mean? And the other thing, we sponsored a job fair and a college, two separate. And the job fair was in January. On a bitter cold day, it was
-16.
Yeah, it was in January. It was cold to be. And I told our community, I said, really lucky to get 10 or 15 people for our job fair. And we held it at St. Agnes Church, all the part of our gym. The gym.
Right.
The list of the stuff. I know that I'm getting mixed up with the job fair. And we had 400 people came, signed in. I always insist on this. We signed in. 400 people came to our job fair. And I said, where can those people park? There's no parking at Central Park, no parking at 160. How they got here, they were desperate. They needed jobs, so they came 400 people. So people come to this neighborhood.
Oh, absolutely.
From all over. Yeah. All over the city, all over the city. They come from Wisconsin.
This little village
Odeum would be an ideal thing to have in Little Village.
I've actually been to the parade. Mm-hmm. So I do know somebody, and I will tell you that where people park when they want to come, they will find someplace. Just like when I go to the north side to shop. I know I'm never going to park in front of where I want to go. So I'm like 4 or 5 blocks, you know, just driving, trying to find. So people will find it. The challenge is if there's a way for us to make it easier and to give more parking opportunities, how can we work with you to do that? So.
And just for your information, this community, if you go from Sacramento to Cicero, has 10 banks. So that means there's a lot of money here. Because there's every bank is in this block, in this mile stretch. And they want to come in right now. So we're trying to not saturate because of banks. There has to be a lot of money in here. There's 10 banks. I think we're the only community that has the 10 banks.
That's a lot. Because
you have Citibank, Fifth Third, Second Federal Savings, Bank of America, PNC, Marquette Bank,
TCF.
So there's a lot of banks. So it must be there's a lot of money.
Well, I have to leave also. However, I just want to say thank you for the info. And like Bernie said, we gotta find out here. And then we work our way up. And then we can start moving around and finding out. Because, like you said before, whether you like it or not, the alderman's in here for a reason, whether he comes to our meetings or not. I know we're kind of disappointed in him and what he hasn't done for us. However, he is the alderman in the ward, and we got to work through him somehow to figure that out because he has say in the city council.
Do you cover, because it's split up, right? Alderman Governess has a portion of the village.
Yeah.
Because you're not just a quarter, you're
3/4.
You're the 26th. You go on Kenzie too.
That's no.
You don't go that far.
Evelyn, let me tell you something. The last remapping of the war, I've been in it 38 years. I'm not on the call.
I got
the 12th war. I'm not on the 22nd war. I'm Now, I live in Christiana, Now the map goes, which one cuts me out of the 22nd war, I'm out of the call.
Well, it's probably the alderman did a lot of remapping. For example, where I live now in the 4th ward.
Yeah, but I want
goes to all the way. No, let me just this is funny. It's not one alderman. It's them getting together and looking and making agreements as to where their wards will
go. I understand the process.
So yeah, it's.
I've watched when Big Mel used to chair the remapping. What's the old lady? He's the lead in charge of the ward in Chicago. He's the chairman of this committee. I used to go to all of them. I know how the process works.
Yeah, they decide how.
And this alderman here cut me out of the 22nd ward.
So my question was, when something happens on that end, you work with Alderman Cardenas.
Cardenas is a friend.
So you work with both aldermen, yes. So it's like the entire But it's not just like the work that you do in the 22nd work, you can work in the 12th.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. We'll work with Alderman.
When he introduced his part, we were not crazy for it, but at least he came to us. And he got us to know what he was doing in his part. And we find that as a sign of respect, because he respects our opinion.
Yeah. He came to the committee.
Yeah, so the park is in the 12th, right?
Right, in the 12th. Yeah. But he came to us and said, can I present my part? Right. I was against it, but you know, like I said, at least the guy had respect to come to the community and say, this is what I'm planning. This guy wouldn't even return our phone calls. Mm-hmm. And I know Rick before he was an alderman. I grew up here too. Yeah. He was the assistant to me, Chuy is the same year. So we want to bring something different. We want to change the neighborhood. We don't get paid. We do it out of the kindness of our heart. So our proposals are genuine, with including everybody, not just a group. Mm-hmm. We want to include everybody. You know, if this guy wants to put on a taco stand there, bring him in. Anybody that wants to make money, that wants to progress, that's the thing that we want. Because this neighborhood is one of the best neighborhoods there is in Chicago. It's just let it go to waste and let more crime come in.
It's the highest crossing.
Yeah.
Aside from obviously downtown.
Yeah, but out of all the communities, we're number one in tax revenue. Yeah, we want to bring in more money.
Yeah.
We bring in more money to the city. But the reason we picked this, because people were telling us the reason we're dropping out of school is because my mom and my dad can't afford to support us. So the kid has to go to work. Mm-hmm. So jobs is needed here. Mm-hmm. And that's why kids are doing bad things, because there's nothing to do.
Right.
Let's go bust some windows and they go do them. So this will bring down the crime, it will bring down a lot of the things that are going on in the neighborhood. It will benefit us in such a way that everybody's gonna benefit in one way or another. And just to say, hey, I have my expo in Little Village, I think that's key right there, to say I'm here, my expo in Little Village. It just put us in the map for the change.
I agree.
Yeah, we'd like to meet with you again.
Yes.
Follow up. And we could fill this room up. We can get different venues. The church, gym, the park, gym, anything. We could fill up.
Let me go back here. Like I said, you guys have given me my marching orders. So let me go back and at least start getting you this information so I can get it out to this group. I have your email address. And I have your card. And he can make sure that everybody,
and Augie would send our email exchanges.
Okay, good. Mm-hmm. And so Evelyn and I are going to go back. She doesn't know it yet, but she's going to help me do some of this homework.
Yeah. Every time I go to meetings,
yes. We'll work for the betterment.
Absolutely.
Prosper, get people opportunities and so on. Mm-hmm. We're not closed. My world. I know we're talking about this from the day it started. Mm-hmm. And I shake hands with him. He says, "Oh, here, even our manager." And it's true too,
Okay.
So I'm a dating person. Mm-hmm. I started acting with Richard J. Davis and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I worked at City Hall. Mm-hmm. I worked for the City for 14 years. I was a manager of customer service for the department. I was a manager for the information booth at City Hall.
Yes.
When we walked in there, that was my station.
Okay.
I ran that. And a lot of people.
Absolutely.
A lot of people for 14 years. Mm-hmm. People gravitated to the mm-hmm. information booth. It's a very fancy information. But, no, we want this community to be a better, prosper.
Right.
And we need information. Okay. And we need your support. And you do it for me.
Yeah, I think in terms of information sharing, where we're linked up and going back to the Department of Planning and figuring out for us who owns what is a first step.
Yeah.
What's the best for the community? What's the best project?
Also, our president, Augie Sallas, has tried to meet the mayor if it's possible. I think that request is still being made today, mm-hmm. that we can have a face-to-face with the mayor just to, Also, every Saturday, he holds a meeting at the Candela's restaurant at 8 o'clock in the morning. If the mayor one day wants to have breakfast with Candelas?
Los Candelas.
I'm sorry. Yeah, Candelas.
I have a breakfast club, and we have various different people come. We have judges come, we've had state reps, we've had state senators, we've had different people come. Mm-hmm. Every Saturday, 8 o'clock, at Los Candelas.
And you get a good breakfast.
And we have a good breakfast. Yeah. It doesn't treat breakfast, except the guests. The guests
okay.
But, we still like to see the mayor.
Well, I know he's going to be trying to get out and about now that the weather's breaking at least, so he's,
yeah.
I know that he's charged our department and others to make sure that he can get out a little more, because he likes to get out.
I support the mayor.
So, he likes
to I'm not a chewing person. Mm-hmm. I'd rather have it. Mm-hmm. Or Ricardo Vinas. Mm-hmm. I'm a regular.
Well, we're not political.
That's what they say.
We're public servants. But no, I think in terms of bringing up the mayor, he's very interested in coming back to Little Village, particularly the climate of immigration where we're in and a lot of the business.